Okay. Well, this will be part three of Whom Shall He Teach Knowledge? And as far as you're able, if you'll join me as we kneel in prayer. Loving Father, it is your voice that we want to hear. We're considering this theme you have set before us concerning the knowledge that prevents us from going into darkness. The knowledge itself, Father, we're understanding is light. And Father, as we take up again this study, I plead with you, please, Father, let it be your voice, not mine. I want to get out of the way. I want to hear what you have to say. And I pray that your Holy Spirit now, as he would take possession of my mind and my mouth, would lead us through your word and lift up Jesus before us in such a powerful way that we would be drawn unto him. We thank you, Father, for hearing our prayer. We also want to make sure that we ask that you would send your holy angels to minister unto us and that they would fill this tent, Father, that they would set a hedge about us all, that we might hear your words, setting aside the distractions of the enemy, the cares of life, whatever it may be that he's trying to force into our minds. I pray now that you would bless us with a clear thought. We thank you, Father, and we pray this in Jesus' glorious name. Amen. You know, the more you present, the more ignorant you really feel, because you realize that only God can assemble the truth for us. Man can relate it, and the worst thing that could possibly happen is that man thinks that it's all about him. We were looking at, as we closed in part two yesterday, we were looking at precepts and principles and defining them as found in the Word of God and in the spirit of prophecy. And we began with Psalms 119, identifying that the precepts that our studies are to include or to embrace all the time are stemming from God's law. Now, friends, as you're sitting here, please understand that this is not just some man's rant. This is what the Spirit of God is wanting us to understand is absolutely critical here at the end of the world. And I want to hopefully visually set this before our minds to consider. Now, we were looking at some quotes, and I want to take up from where we were. Yesterday, we dealt with the last one being in Review and Herald, February 18th, 1890, paragraph 9. It was the work of Christ to present the truth in the framework of the gospel and to reveal the precepts and principles that he had given to fallen man. Now, Jesus, as I was saying, is our example in all things. And when Jesus was to teach the people, he was the teacher. And yet, he was pointing them to the very things that are found where? In the Word of God, that they should have already been familiar with. But were they familiar with them?
No.
Now, how is that? These are the people that were entrusted with the greatest light. You realize this? And yet, they didn't even recognize Jesus. Now, there were a lot of reasons for this, but the bottom line is that they understood the letter of the law, but what did they not understand?
The
spirit of the law. And the spirit of the law, what does he speak expressly of? The will of the Father. And what is the will of the Father? Sister White tells us, it's the commandments of God. If we're to know the doctrine, the Bible says we must do his will. That must mean that we have to keep his commandments. That makes sense to me. Okay, now I want to read you another manuscript release, volume 8, page 61. The study of the Bible is to occupy a large place. Its precepts and principles are to be prayerfully and daily studied. Notice why. That teachers and students may be prepared for the higher school in the heavenly courts. So when we're studying the Bible and we're understanding that precepts and principles are that which are revealing to us the very character of God, the standard of entrance into God's kingdom, then we're understanding why this is preparatory for us standing on the sea of glass. Okay, so listen, I want to show you something now. Oh, there's what? There's boards up here. Okay. Now, what I want you to consider is this, all right? There are those that are saying, oh, brother, please, how much love can we take? How much? Is it all really necessary? What was the third step in the process? Do you remember? Right? The final part. What was the first step in every reform? What is it that God brings? Do you remember? A prophetic warning message. We saw it in Jonah. We saw it with Noah. We saw it in the Millerite history. Didn't we? Okay, upon the testimony of two or three. These things are established. But what is the second aspect of every reform? It's reform. It's personal reform. Now, what I was also identifying, and I just want to set this again in our minds so that I can reference this for us. The latter rain is more than just a prophetic warning message. The latter rain embraces also the personal reform. When is it that judgment is meted out upon Adventists? When does judgment begin to be poured out upon a people who have had the greatest light? At the National Sunday Law. So let me set this in your mind visually. National Sunday Law. So let me ask you, is the latter rain any good for you and I in our character development in reforming us beyond the Sunday Law? No, because there is a statement of Sister White's that says plainly that when the decree goes forth and the stamp is impressed, our characters will remain pure and spotless for eternity. Now, I just want to pause here for a minute, okay? There are those that are understanding incorrectly in God's church today that we, beyond the Sunday Law, you still have a chance. Yeah. You can still make a choice. And do you know what that is? That's the Adventist version of 7 years of tribulation. Where we can still get our act together. Friends, we have so many quotes that reveal that it is here that a character is revealed, not obtained. You remember the parable with the oil, the character. That oil is character. It is also the Holy Spirit. Yes, it is. It is also messages. But it is here that we are to have the oil, not go looking for the oil. We have to have the character. God is saying to you and I today, all right, these two steps are absolutely critical. I want to show you something. Go to Exodus. The Lord just led me in this thought. Now, there is a statement in the spirit of prophecy, and I can only, at this moment, quote it to you because I didn't think to put it into my notes, and I'm not going to take the time again to go find it. But if you have her writings, you'll find this quickly. She says, the scenes connected with the close of probation and the work of preparation. What is it that Satan was trying to divert our minds from? Preparing a people to stand. What are they getting ready to stand through? The greatest storm that has ever broke upon his people. So there's a work of preparation. And what I'm saying to you is in these two steps, these two parts of a process, there is a preparation that's going on. All right. Let's notice from Exodus 19 what it is. Okay, so in Exodus 19, what we're seeing is that the children of Israel are coming to the Mount Sinai. They have come and parked themselves at the base of it. And then God calls Moses up into the mount. Okay? Verse 3, and Moses went up unto God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, thus shalt thou say unto the house of Jacob. And he says, tell the children of Israel, and then he gives them a message to tell them. So then Moses goes back down the mountain, and notice verse 7, and Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before their faces all of these words which the Lord commanded him. And what did they say? All that the Lord hath spoken we will do, in verse 8. Okay, so they're willing to enter into the what? The covenant, all right? But what does every covenant have to have? It has to have laws. It has to have things that govern it, parameters. Or you can say, oh, I didn't know that. And it can't be binding without law. Okay? So watch what happens. Verse 9, and the Lord said unto Moses, lo, I come unto thee in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with thee, and believe thee forever. And Moses told the words of the people unto the Lord. Now watch this. And the Lord said unto Moses, go unto the people, and sanctify them, how long? Today
and tomorrow.
Right here, okay? Follow this now. Today and tomorrow. Sanctify the people. What's happening in the courtyard? Justification. What's happening in the holy place? Sanctification in the most holy place? Glorification. Do I glorify myself? Can I attain sanctification? Now, I'm not saying apart from Christ, but can I attain sanctification?
Yes.
Am I not told, sanctify yourselves?
Yes.
Can I glorify myself?
No.
I can't. I can't be in the third apartment. I can't be eating manna that is not hidden. Moses said, put it in there that the children of Israel may see that the Lord is good. We can't be in the most holy place. There's no such thing as a most holy place experience as taught today. Our most holy place experience is you and I sending our prayers into the most holy place by faith, believing that the blood of Jesus is efficacious in overcoming our sins, washing away our sins. Do you follow me? All right, so we're looking at the first 2 days. Watch this. It's a process. At the end of the process, I want to tell you that you are entering into covenant with the God of creation. Are you excited about that?
Amen.
But if we're looking at the process and we're barking at the second phase of the process, which is to become like Jesus, to adopt His character of love, well, don't go to heaven. Okay? If you don't like love, don't go to heaven. Just stay here. But those that are going to be standing on that sea of glass, they're going to know about the holy kiss. I don't claim to know anything about that yet, but I believe that that's what we're going to experience, whatever is entailed with that, not in the human flesh, but we're going to see a love that we've never seen before as we climb higher on God's ladder. The third day, notice, go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow. What does that mean? And let them wash their clothes. What is that? What is washing clothes pointing to? Why do they need to wash the clothes? Because they're dirty. What's made them dirty? Sin. Okay? So they need to wash their clothes. They need to put away sin in the first day and the second day. Through the prophetic warning message and the personal reform, through line upon line with precept upon precept, we are to reform. We are to become like Jesus. And by beholding, we become changed into that same image that we're beholding. How can God show you where you're off unless it's through His precepts that are speaking of His law? So when we're studying the Bible and we're just embracing a method of study, but we're not seeing in our study, nothing stands out for us as a mirror saying, brother, this is where you are deficient, sister. This is you. This is you it's talking about. If we're not seeing that, how are we to grow? If we're walking around in the darkness, how are we going to know where we are? How are we going to know we're right at the precipice? All right, here's what happens. Verse 11. And be ready against the third day. For the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. Interesting. God's going to come down. Where is He going to come down? On the mount. What's on the mount? Verse 12, and thou shalt set bounds unto the people round about. Round about what? Around about that mountain. Now listen, you got to see this. This mountain, this place where God and Jesus... There's another study that I did recently that's on our website, childrenoflight.org, entitled Another Gospel. Sister White will tell us that when Moses was standing before Jesus on the mountain, on Mount Sinai, that Moses was prefiguring Jesus, interceding on behalf of the people. So who did Jesus represent? The Father. What was being represented in that moment? The most holy place experience that Jesus and the Father are involved in. Jesus is there as Moses was, pleading on behalf of you and I. All right? But here's what's important. Where the Father and Jesus are today, just as where Jesus and Moses were in that history, there are boundaries that are set. And God is saying, no one can come in here. No one can even put their hand on this mountain that they're not destroyed. You get the picture? It's a holy place. We can't go there. It goes on to say, saying, take heed to yourselves, in verse 12, that ye go not up into the mount or touch the border of it. Whosoever toucheth the mount shall be surely put to death. There shall not a hand touch it, but he shall surely be stoned or shot through, whether it be beast or man, it shall not live. When the trumpet soundeth long, they shall come up to the mount. And Moses went down from the mount unto the people and sanctified the people, and they washed their clothes. And he said unto the people, be ready against the third day. Come not at your wives. And it came to pass on the third day in the morning that there were thunders and lightnings and a thick cloud upon the mount. Do you know where else you see thunder, lightning, and thick clouds? In the most holy place, when the Father moved from the throne with wheels, rolled into the most holy place, and Jesus says, come with me, in 1844. Is that what he said? He said, wait here while I go to my Father. Where are they when he says that? They're in the holy place, right? They're before the table of showbread, representing the altar, the location of that altar, because it's on the north and Jesus is the true King of the North. But the Father rolls into the most holy place. Jesus is about to go in there because there's a new work that has to begin. And he says to his people, and who are they? They're the ones that were bowed down, but when Jesus arose, they arose with him. They followed Jesus. They weren't the ones who were still bowed down. And Jesus tells these, wait here while I go to my Father, and I will return. There's no following Jesus into the most holy place. Leviticus 16:17 says, no man on the Day of Atonement can enter into that apartment. Now, that's not the burden of what I'm trying to share, but I needed to make that point because we're right there. What I'm wanting to emphasize in what we're talking about right now is that the second day is what we're dealing with. The first day is about putting away sin. It's about being prepared. This is the time, brothers and sisters, this is the time of preparation. The scenes connected with the close of probation and the work of preparation are clearly revealed. But multitudes have no more understanding of them than if they had never been revealed. That's what she tells us. Something's wrong. Why can't they see? They don't see the work of preparation because they're in darkness. Darkness is meaning that they don't understand who God is, and they don't understand God, who He is. Why? Because they study simply line upon line. They don't bring in the precepts, the laws, the principles of God's Word that Jesus Himself teaches by, that He holds up to you and I just like His law, for it is His law, and as a mirror is showing you and I where we're deficient today. So I want you to understand that when I'm emphasizing for precept must be upon precept, I'm doing that because that's the only way you can exist in the second phase. That's the only way you can succeed in the second leg of this work, in the second day of washing your garments. If you're not understanding from God's Word what you're doing wrong, why are you reading it? Why are you studying it? Amen?
Amen.
Do you agree with me? We need to know who the Father is. Because the principle, as I've said so many times before, is that by beholding, we do. Not maybe, not on a good day, we become changed. It's a law just like the laws that bring that sun up and around this earth every day. Which, by the way, I don't believe is flat. Okay, I believe that sun comes up by laws that God set in place, and there are laws that are designed to transform our character. Amen? And when I'm telling you something, listen, when you're looking at the Bible and it's teaching you something you don't want to hear about yourself, oh, brothers and sisters, don't turn away. Take hold of that bull by both horns. Plead for power and strength, but we've got to overcome. We can't keep preaching about it and talking about it. I can't stand up here unless my life is better than it was last year. I'm not making any progress. And I will end up being a castaway myself.
Wesley, aren't we told to go in there by understanding His works and entering by faith?
All right, there's an intellectual following that occurred in the Millerite history. My sister asked a question. So here's what Sister White teaches. That they followed Jesus by faith into the most holy place. Faith doesn't eat. Faith believes. And it believes on what?
The
Word of God. They had an increase of understanding. That was the light given to Hiram Edson in the cornfield. They understood what the sanctuary was all about. And in understanding that, they now had the broad picture, which is reflected in the lower left-hand corner of the sanctuary on the 1850 chart. So when they understand the sanctuary, now they understand that Jesus wasn't coming to earth. He was moving from the holy to the most holy. And by faith, they believed, meaning that they followed Him. But their prayers are the only thing that can go in there. Hebrews says we can come boldly before that throne of grace, which is at that altar at the veil that was there. But we enter in, Hebrews is very clear, by Jesus Christ. We don't go in. We are working in the holy place to become sanctified by that blood that He's in there now sprinkling on our behalf. But it's by faith that we believe that we can overcome. It's not by our strength. It's not an emotional mustering up of a determination today, I'm going to overcome my temper. We can't do that. You'll never do it. And honestly, I want to forewarn you. Listen carefully. In order for you to be saved, you're going to have to be put into positions where you are not in control, and you will drown unless you call out to Jesus.
Amen.
You can't know the need of a Savior until you put it in a position where you realize it's way bigger than you. Amen? Coming out here, our motorhome, I checked everything out on it. Everything worked beautiful. When I got behind that driving steering wheel, 101 in patience began. 101 in faith began. Everything began to fail and have problems. And it came with such force and so much, so often, that I had to go to the back of my motorhome and pray and ask, Lord, what are You doing? Why are You doing this to us? And of course, in there, the Lord speaks to me and says, how else can I purify you? How else? What do you think these trials are going to look like? You think they're going to be nice and pleasant? So you can just real easy say, I choose the Lord. I choose to believe in the Lord. God is going to bring us into these two stages in order to refine us, to remove the dross. But Jesus, make no mistake, is in the most holy place. Sister White will never tell you and I that we are in there in type, symbolically. Find a thus saith the Lord. Now let's go back to what Pastor Howard and Pastor Chapman have been talking about, the principles in God's Word. And I believe we're going to deal with literal spiritual in the very near future. Friends, we need to come back to the basics. Show me two testimonies of thus saith the Lord that we can be in the most holy place. You won't find them. And even better yet, find me two scriptures or the spirit of prophecy that identify the manna of Revelation 2:17 as the hidden manna that's in the ark in the most holy place. You won't find them. I challenge you. You won't find them. But see, when we are using a line upon line method of study apart from precept upon precept, well now, we don't have a steering wheel. We can take the subject wherever we want to go. We can divorce the language from the very setting and context that it was born in. And we can move it to somewhere else. I've wandered a bit. Let me come back now, because my focus is these two. I wanted to emphasize for us that we have to understand what Jesus is doing. There is a work of preparation that He's doing right now in your heart and mine. And it's apart from your spouse, it's apart from your children, it's apart from you and your church. This is one-on-one with you. Do you want to be saved? Is what He's asking you every day you wake up. Well, let's go. That's what we have to realize. And it's not nice, it's not pretty, but we can have peace. We can find comfort and joy in Christ's work within us. Now, I want to read to you, Brother Pastor Howard yesterday shared a couple of quotes with you. I just want to remind us of these quotes because of what they're telling us. Prophets and Kings, if you have yesterday's handout, Prophets and Kings, it's the fourth quote. Page 626, she says, Christians should be preparing for what is soon to break upon the world as an overwhelming surprise. What is that surprise? The national Sunday law, where America forms an image to the beast and you and I are subject to it, and persecutes those who keeps the true Sabbath. Now, I want you to see something. It's to break upon us as an overwhelming surprise. But wait a minute, we're standing here now talking about this Sunday law. It's not going to catch me by surprise. Oh yes, it will. When she's saying that to you and I who teach it and preach it, it's still coming as an overwhelming surprise. Think about that. So how are you going to be prepared for something you know is going to overwhelm you? You ever been in the surf and the wave that hits you? It's with such force that you're just driven to the ground and tossed and rolled up the bank. Have you ever had that experience? It's amazing the power of that wave, but you're powerless to resist it. So what I'm saying to you is the only way we're going to be able to deal with what's coming as an overwhelming surprise is to be holding the hand of Jesus Christ. If you don't have a living connection with Him right now, if by faith you cannot walk right through the trials in your life, holding onto His hand, knowing that there is relief and there's a purpose for it all, and that He's going to sustain you and He desires only your good, if you're not thinking these things and experiencing this through every trial, you're not going to make it through the Sunday law. It's the time of preparation, brothers and sisters. And the preparation involves you and I knowing who Jesus is. So let's, when we start studying our Bible now, let's understand that what we're to see in there are the very principles of God's law that are showing us what we're doing wrong. We see the Bible teaching about selflessness, self-sacrifice, the good of others, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, not before they do unto you. We need to adopt the very character of the God that we're going to stand beside throughout all eternity. Another, Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, page 273. Our people need to understand the oracles of God. They need to have a systematic knowledge of the principles of revealed truth. So we've got a prophetic warning message. Did you catch the principles in it? Did you see the principles in that message? Because they're there. Which will fit them, these principles, will fit them for what is coming upon the earth and prevent them from being carried about by every wind of doctrine. Now, come on. Are there every wind of doctrine blowing today? Amen. There are those that feel that the king of the north is now Turkey. I'm not here to debate these subjects. There are those that feel that the earth is flat. Dear close friends of mine believe this, and they're sincere in this. There are those that are teaching the dateline issue out on the islands somewhere at the equator, where the day is actually right down the middle of that island. They're debating on which day is Saturday and which day is Sunday, because it falls right in the middle of the island. According to the course of the sun, well, if I step over here, now it's Sabbath. Or if I step over here, now it's Sunday. All within the same day when the sun is shining. So what I'm saying is that every wind of doctrine, there are those now teaching that the Sunday law isn't even a test for us, in spite of the plain statements in the spirit of prophecy and the Bible. What is our message today? Someone is going to come behind me that's going to expound upon this, but what is our message today? Do you know? What is the message we're to be giving? The three angels' messages, correct? We're waiting for that third to be empowered by the fourth angel at the Sunday law crisis. When the loud cry goes forth, the Spirit of God is poured out without measure. We need to stay focused on our work. We need to focus on the preparation that you and I are now going through. If you're wondering why your life is like it is, if you're having troubles, if you're not, you need to be greatly concerned. But if you're having trials, it's because God has you in the fires. Listen, it's a very painful process, but we've got to go through it. Okay, enough said. Let me read to you also from the Lord has brought my mind back to the original quote that I read to you. I want to finish the quote that was in Prophets and Kings. It's so short, I'll just reread it. Christians should be preparing for what is soon to break upon the world as an overwhelming surprise. And this preparation they should make by, you want to be ready for the storm? Here's how. By diligently studying the Word of God. And, okay, so you can't just be a hearer. There's an and. And striving to conform their lives to its precepts. Amen. All right? The scenes connected with the close of probation, they're clearly revealed now. There you go. Daniel 11, 40-45. They're clearly revealed, but multitudes have no more understanding of them than if they'd never been revealed. But there's a work of preparation. This is the same work outlined and identified in Exodus 19, the 2 days to wash your garments, because on the third day, that's where you are either part of God's people. And what happened on the third day in Exodus 19? The law is spoken. They have entered in fully now into the covenant. They have said, all that thou hast said we will do. God says, here's the law that will govern this contract between you and I. And that's what they kept breaking. Now, I want to share something else with you. Okay, so I am pointing you to these 2 days. I'm sharing with you that not only are we to settle in intellectually, but we're to settle in spiritually. That we're not just to become a hearer of the Word, but a doer of the Word. As you go through the Bible, you're going to start seeing this two-step process. And these two apartments are the only place that you and I can impact the final result. Do you follow me? That's the only place. Now, I'm sharing this with you, and there are those who are saying, oh, brother, all this love stuff, really? I mean, you know, haven't we heard enough of that? Give me some more prophecy. Well, I want to tell you something. There are a lot of intellectual Christians. They don't want to study with the precepts because the precepts are going to identify where they need to change, and they don't want to change. What do we read? They love darkness rather than light. The darkness is hatred. Hatred for those who are in the light of God's love. And that love is power that equates to transformation of character. Now, A.T. Jones wrote a sermon entitled, Our God is a Consuming Fire. And he wrote this and actually presented it at the Battle Creek Tabernacle on October the 22nd, 1898. And it was found in the Review and Herald January 24th through February the 7th, 1899. It was three weekend publications there. But I want to read you an excerpt from this, okay? And it pertains to who God is going to have to destroy and why. I'm relating a truth to you now that God says you must know and understand. Remember, my people are destroyed for lack of what?
Knowledge.
And why were they lacking it?
They rejected it.
And as a result, they received strong delusion in 2 Thessalonians 2. Do you want that?
No.
Well, I want to. This was so beautiful when I read this, and so plain. I love the way these men wrote and thought. Yeah. All right? So watch this. He's speaking about the day of the Lord as in the second coming of Christ. But we know today that the coming of Christ, not in His physical second appearing, but as in judgment, where judgment begins for us, is at the Sunday law crisis. And I will find those quotes. Dealing with the day of the Lord, he says, continuing from where we read a moment ago, then shall that wicked, he's talking about 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Because they received not the love of the truth. What did they not do?
They didn't receive the love of it.
They did not receive the love of the truth, watch, that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they might all be damned who believed not the truth and had pleasure in unrighteousness, chose darkness rather than light. I want to be an intellectual Christian. I'm in the prophetic warning message. Brother, you need to come and stand on the platform. Well, the platform got a lot bigger than what you thought it was. The platform that Sister White was standing on, that she was still standing on in 1903, as identified in the General Conference Bulletin of that year, was the truths that were set up behind them, that light, and it's set up behind me. This was the platform. Who changed it? People say, oh, this brother's off the platform. This brother's off the platform. I'm not. I am off of man's platform. Hallelujah, I am. But I'm still on the platform that Jesus said was good enough for his prophet and for his people and at Reformed history. This is the platform. This is our foundation. Believed not the truth, Jones points out. He's reiterating. Believed not the truth. They knew of it. Now listen carefully, because this is you and me. They knew of it. It was presented to them. Their hearts told them. The Spirit of God told them that it was truth. Their own consciences approved of it all. But they would not believe the truth. Would not believe. They had pleasure in unrighteousness and held down and pressed back the truth in unrighteousness and, quote, for this cause, unquote. It is that the wrath of God is revealed from heaven and strikes them. God is not willing that any should perish. But brothers and sisters, let us not believe not the truth. The truth of the matter is that when we're studying, God has ordained in Isaiah 28, verses 9 to 13, the premier method, the core, the nucleus of every study that is to bring us to the foot of the cross is to reveal to us what we're doing wrong. How we can be prepared, just between you and I in Christ. I want to read to you as well from the North Pacific Union Gleaner, May 22nd. That's NPU Gleaner, May 26, 1909, sorry, paragraph 7. The study of the Bible should occupy a large place in our schoolwork. Its precepts and principles are to be prayerfully and daily studied. All the instruction given should be based on, now if you're teaching, if you have a school and you're teaching, notice what she says. All the instruction given should be based on the principles revealed in the life and teachings of Christ. That's what you're to be teaching your students. Why? Why do you think? Can I just teach them this awesome line upon line parallel? Show them how this symbol means that symbol and it teaches all of this? Can I just do that? Is that what God designed the Bible to do? God left us these instructions so that we might know what it is that we have to change in order to be prepared to meet with Him in peace. This is the time to follow in our experience the plan of Christ for the inculcation of the Word of God, principles that men may carry with them into the future life. I want the principles and precepts in every study that I'm involved in now. When I'm involved in any study, or if I'm listening to someone else's study, ask yourself at the end of the study, what did I discover about myself that I need to change? Now listen, if you do that, you're going to stop sitting in front of some people. You're going to change channels. Because friends, we're in a time of preparation. Just before the storm is about to break, how much time do you have for commercials? We need the straight testimony. And the straight testimony in the Word of God is His principles and His precepts. They're telling you, Wesley, if you don't get this straight soon, brother, you're not going anywhere. I'm going to have to pass you by. I love you and I don't want to do that. But Sister White says there are souls perishing in the very shadows of our churches. And listen, God is long-suffering, and I've said this many times, but He's not forever suffering. He is patient, but that patience has an end, and He tells us that. The Bible contains all the principles that men need to understand in order to be fitted either for this life or for the life to come. And these principles may be understood by all. When thus searched out and brought together, they will be found to be perfectly fitted to one another. Every principle in the Word of God has its place, every fact its bearing, and the complete structure in design and execution bears testimony to its author. Such a structure, no mind but that of the infinite could conceive or fashion. God built in to the Bible all of His precepts through parables, through stories, through life accounts. Did David and Bathsheba teach us any principles? Okay. What about her husband and the destruction of her husband? Did that teach us some principles? What about Absalom? What about Samson? Did he teach us any principles? Brothers and sisters, we got to see them. These are the things that are to... This is the nutrition that if we had a spiritual bricks meter, we'd send that thing off the scale. In nutrition, spiritually. We need spiritual nutrition. Organic, as we've been understanding, organic isn't all there is. Organic just means that that's giving you a little bit of a leg up, but that in itself does not give you nutritious food. And line upon line by itself will never give you nutritious food. Okay. I want to identify that in these two steps, this is the latter rain that's falling. That latter rain embraces both the prophetic warning message and the work of preparation, the personal reform. And we know this because she says that the latter rain is to ripen the grain and prepare it for the harvest. And a prophetic warning message will never do that by itself. We have to take up the work that lies at our own feet. Young and old, it doesn't matter. When Jesus is standing there, you can't say, well, my parents didn't tell me that. Well, could you read? Well, yeah, but you could have read. We're not only judged by the light we've had, but by the light we could have had, she says. We are responsible. And I've said this before. It's your salvation. Do you really want to get onto the sea of glass? Do you want to be standing there on the sea of glass that's mingled with fire? Welcoming people you haven't seen in forever that you were separated by death from? People that reflected Jesus to you, that led you to this sea of glass? The reunion, the homecoming, if you will. It's yours, but you've got to take up the work of dying to self and overcoming. Now, John 17:17, you know what it says. Sanctify them. Through what?
Truth.
Thy truth, thy word is truth. And I've said this before. There are brothers, then they're sincere, but they're sincerely misguided. They think, okay, well, I read the Bible the whole year. I went through the Bible reading plan. Now I am ready. I'm sanctified through the truth. Now, I know they don't really believe that. But I keep getting as a rebuff, as a push-off, when I'm pointing them to principles, they're saying, sanctify them to thy truth. Thy word is truth. This brother is teaching. I don't see any error in what they're teaching. Well, notice in Psalms 19 again. Psalms 19, where sanctification is coming from. Is it the word abroad? Is it the fact that you have read the Bible? Or is Jesus, has he built something in that must be observed, understood, and obeyed? Notice Psalms 19, verse 7. The law of the Lord.
Amen.
This is where the precepts and principles are coming from. That's why it was that it must be, for precept must be upon precept. You cannot study and understand God and know who He is apart from His precepts. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. There you go. Sanctification doesn't come from a method of study. It comes from a method of study that's combined with the focus that God intended that study to have. And that's the character of God. Because by beholding, we become changed. Now, I know I'm repeating myself, and I'm not bothered by that. I hope that when you leave here, that God will be able to bring that back to your mind. Repetition deepens the impression. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. You may not like the commandments, but if you don't like the commandments, then you don't like the character of God, and you don't like love.
Amen.
And you love darkness.
Amen.
The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. Those that are truly in darkness are not searching the Scriptures to discover the character of God, one precept at a time, line upon line, precept upon precept. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. Now it's interesting, the fear of the Lord is marked out as the same as the law, the commandments of God, the fear of the Lord. That's interesting. Mark that in your own mental notes there. Now I want to read something to you from the pen of inspiration concerning this. It's almost like, well, I can just, and they're teaching this, I can just study this particular message, and this message is so incredible, so full of light, that if I just study it and understand it and comprehend it, I've been told in the public forums, in videos on YouTube, that my character will be transformed supernaturally. And you won't even be aware. It's like the computer uploading in the background, you know, updating itself. Now, that's being taught. But how do we guard ourselves against it? How do we know if that's true or not? Precept upon precept, precept upon precept will guide us. That's the focus of every study. The law of God does not allow that. The worship of man, the worship of the teachings of men. The law of God says, I am God and there is no other.
Amen.
So, this is what she says, and this is taken from 1888 materials, page 806, or if you're looking it up in her writings, 1888, 806.1 is where we begin. I have felt to urge upon all the necessity of searching the Scriptures for themselves. Praise the Lord. Brothers and sisters, take this counsel. No matter how young you are, how old you are, no matter your experience, search and study for yourselves. That they may know what is truth and may discern more clearly the compassion and love of God. Yet there is need of carefulness and earnest prayer in the study of the Bible. So you don't just read it and when the thoughts come you just adopt them. You've got to pray over these things. That none may fall into error by misconception of its teachings. There is one great central truth. This tends to get exclusive. When others are vying to put their theme of thought in there. The servant of the Lord, Jesus, through the pen of inspiration, has said, there is one great central truth to be kept ever before the mind in the searching of the Scriptures. You know what it is?
Christ and Him crucified.
Christ and Him crucified. Oh, brother, can we just get back to prophecy? Come on, I like the warning. I can deal with a warning. I'm good at warning other people. But I don't want to get into this principle stuff. God's talking to me. I know I need to get ready, and I'm getting ready. I'm experiencing changes. Really? Well, in the public forums, it doesn't seem to be showing in the way that you talk, in the way that you relate to people. What about in your social life? What about in your home life? with your children and family. She goes on and says, every other truth is invested with influence and power corresponding to its relation to this theme. So if you're teaching something that's not connected with the theme of Christ and Him crucified, doesn't have any power. Doesn't have any power. I'm not saying that. Argue with Christ. It is only in the light of the cross. And what's that light that we saw streaming from the cross of Calvary? It's God's love. All right? It is only in the light of the cross, it is only in the love of God that we can discern the exalted character of the law of God. So if love isn't part of your message, you are in darkness. You are the one who is in darkness. And wagging your finger at others and you're standing there in darkness. Love is not part of your message. It is only in the light of the cross that we can discern the exalted character of the law of God. Amen. Why do we need to understand the character of God's law? Because it is God. And a life eternal is about knowing Jesus Christ and His Father. The soul palsied by sin can be endowed with life, here's that word again, only. Are you palsied with sin? Do you struggle with sin as I do? Are you desiring to overcome? It is the soul palsied by sin can be endowed with life only through the work wrought out upon the cross by the author of our salvation. The love of Christ constrains man to unite with Him in his labors and sacrifice. The revelation of divine love, watch this. Here's how it works, okay? Oh, you're saying the cross. Well, there it is. It's right there. Well, there it is. So we're good. We're good to go. We passed the test. We have the cross in our message. Is that what she's saying? Do you feel better now that you see that there? Do you feel closer to God because you see that there? No, it's only by beholding that we become changed. Notice how we behold. She says the revelation of divine love. In other words, His love has to be revealed to you. The revelation of divine love awakens in them a sense of their neglected obligation to be light bearers to the world. Listen, if you want to increase evangelism, preach Christ upon the cross. Because this is what it does. It awakens in them a sense of their neglected obligation to be light bearers to the world and inspires them with a missionary spirit. Listen, why do you think that the disciples went into the upper room? It wasn't to wash their hands and get ready for a great work. They were there to put away differences and to be knit as one in heart in the love of God. Oh, and it wasn't some weak, sick sentimentalism, as some like to identify it. It was a principle. It was the decision of a sanctified will. But it was the power of God to unite man with man. It enlightens the mind and sanctifies the soul. It will banish unbelief and inspire faith. What will? What will do this? The revelation of divine love. Yet, it is the one great truth to be constantly kept before the minds of men. Yet how dimly is the love of God understood? And in the teaching of the Word, it makes but a faint impression. I want to read you a quote, and I'm going to close with this quote. What is our time?
1:42.
Okay. Huh? 2 hours, 2 minutes?
Oh, minutes is... looks like 19.
Okay. This quote, this is the one that when I read this, when I share this with people who are contending that this message is the message. I want you to see something. Now let me state something to you right up front. We are never, ever to let go of our prophetic warning message. You can't. You lose the very thing that is the impetus that drives you to the foot of the cross. And the things that God's going to connect with that to show you even today how much closer His coming is. But all of it is to translate in your experience to a desire to be more like Jesus. Take the Millerite example. Right? That's what they had. They had a prophetic warning message, and it drove them to become more like Jesus.
Amen.
And the masses of them became like Jesus, right?
No.
The overwhelming majority were standing there in the cornfield with Edson, right?
No.
Friends, it's a solemn thing to realize that the overwhelming majority of Adventists are going out. So much so that when they wake up one morning, they're going to realize whole conferences are gone out. The church will appear to fall because there will be nobody having church. Nobody answering the phone on Sabbath. Nobody's there. The parking lot's empty. And we are probably going to be among them. Statistically. But He is able to present us faultless before that throne with exceeding great joy. And the sooner you and I realize we can't save ourselves, that the trials that we're in are actually a blessing in disguise.
Amen.
Then the faster we're going to grow and heal and become like Jesus. And we won't know it. In fact, you know as well as I that the closer we come to Him, the more sinful we're going to feel. We won't be bragging about ourselves. We won't be calling ourselves Melchizedek. We won't be lifting ourselves up as Moses, as Elijah, and all these things. We won't fail the test of John the Baptist, brothers and sisters. And what was his test? I must decrease that He may increase. I'm not going to lift up myself. I want to lift up Jesus. How about you? This quote, she says, this is in Third Selected Messages, page 183. She says, many people seem to be ignorant of what constitutes faith. The just shall live by their faith. Many complain of darkness and discouragements. I asked, are your faces turned toward Jesus? Do you know that even the flowers know to turn their faces toward Jesus every morning? Are you waking up and turning your face to Jesus? Are you beholding Him, the Son of Righteousness? You need plainly to define to the churches the matter of faith and entire dependence upon the righteousness of Christ. Did you catch that? You need plainly to define to the churches, you're the churches, the matter of faith and entire dependence upon the righteousness of Christ. In your talks and prayers there has been so little dwelling upon Christ, His matchless love, His great sacrifice made in our behalf, that Satan has nearly eclipsed the views we should have and must have of Jesus Christ. We don't talk Jesus. We don't talk the cross. So today when you start talking, oh brother, please go sit down. We've heard that. This church was founded on that. We know all about it. We've got some new light. We've got some great light. Go sit down, please. We must trust less in human beings for spiritual help and more, far more, in approaching Jesus Christ as our Redeemer. One-on-one, brothers and sisters, we may dwell with a determined purpose on the heavenly attributes of Jesus Christ. We may talk of His love. Thank you, Father. We may tell and sing of His mercies. We may make Him our own personal Savior. Then we are one with Christ. We love that which Christ loved. We hate sin, that which Christ hated. These things must be talked of, dwelt upon. Now watch. I address the ministers. Well, that's me. That's the rest of us here that are ministers. But guess what? You're ministers in your sphere of influence. But she is talking about the ministers, and this is what she says. I address the ministers, lead the people along step by step, dwelling upon Christ's efficiency until, by a living faith, they see Jesus as He is. See Him in His fullness, a sin-pardoning Savior. You see, Satan doesn't want you to think or believe that your sins can be forgiven. I was speaking with someone recently who believed that they had just sinned too much. They knew too much. And that God just wouldn't take them back. Brother, sister, this is the work of Satan. He is the accuser of the brethren. When you're feeling down, rejoice because the Satan is on your heels because he knows that Jesus is in your life. Don't become discouraged. Praise the Lord. Reach through that darkness. This is right, but we have only casually lifted up Christ. Sorry, I got ahead of myself. One who can pardon all our transgressions, it is by beholding that we become changed into His likeness. This is present truth. We have talked the law. Remember? We've talked the law until the people are dry as the hills of Gilboa. We've preached these two tables back here in parallel to the two tables of the commandments in the Millerite history until the people are again in this history dry as the hills of Gilboa. And she's pointing to this. She says, we have talked the law. This is right. But we have only casually lifted up Christ as the sin-pardoning Savior. Do you see an out-of-balance message, brothers and sisters? Okay, so there's a prophetic warning message. Praise the Lord. Glory to God for giving that to us. But that's not all there is. That's not the latter rain by itself.
Amen.
That's one phase of the latter rain.
Amen.
And I haven't studied this out, but maybe that's the former rain and latter rain combined here at the end of the world. I'm not trying to preach a new doctrine. We have only casually lifted up Christ as a sin-pardoning Savior. Now watch. We're to keep before the mind the sin-pardoning Savior. How many sermons have you heard recently about that? How many prophetic dissertations have done that, have accomplished that? I'll tell you what. I know the Millerites did it. I know that they did it. Why aren't we doing it? But we are to present Him in His true position, coming to die to magnify the law of God and make it honorable, and yet to justify the sinner who shall depend wholly upon the merits of the blood of a crucified and risen Savior. This is not made plain. It's not made plain by our ministers. The soul-saving message. Okay, let's bring it all back to center now. She says, the soul-saving message, the third angel's message, is the message to be given to the world. What's the third angel's message? Go ahead. Fear God. For the hour of His judgment has come. And
worship.
Right, we're doing all three here. What is the third angel's message? Sorry.
It is the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus.
Do we need to turn to our Bibles?
Commandments of God and the faith of Jesus.
We're warning against...
Here's the patience of the saints. Here are they that fear, here are they that keep the commandments and commandments of God and the faith of Jesus.
Okay. We're warning against receiving the mark of the beast.
Yes.
Now listen, when it comes to all these winds of doctrine today, see where they fit into that. Okay? See where they fit into that. Our commission is to go and warn the people that the mark of the beast is about to be stamped upon those who do not know Jesus.
Amen.
Okay? We have so many ministries standing up, I have the message over here, come over here. No, I have the message. This is even greater light. Come over here. So we stand there and we have all of these doors and we don't know which one to walk through. Jesus says it right there, third angel's message. The soul-saving message, the third angel's message is the message to be given to the world. Now watch this. The commandments of God in the sense of the two tables. The commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. The faith of Jesus. The faith. How does faith come? And hearing by?
The word of God.
And what's the word?
Jesus.
Precept upon precept. See, if you don't know who God is, you can't trust in Him. If you don't know who your spouse is, you're not going to get married. He's the bridegroom. We're the bride. You've heard me say that. The faith of Jesus stems from you knowing who He is. You can't trust Jesus when that storm blast hits as an overwhelming surprise unless you are now learning to trust that whatever you're in, He's going to carry you right through it. I mean, it gives me goosebumps when I think about that because I think about my trip coming out here. And I was standing facing a dark wall that had no top and had no sides, no bottom. It just seemed like there was no way I could go any further. And God, when I said, I will trust You even though You slay me, He took my hand and we went right through that wall. And situations just disappeared. Circumstances were gone. They were resolved like that. I have 1,000 ways where you see none. But will you believe in Me? Listen, our faith, we're going to go into this in our last part. Our faith is to work how? What's the fuel of our faith? It's love. It's love. Now, just to finish this thought, she says, The soul-saving message, the third angel's message, is the message to be given to the world. The commandments of God and the faith of Jesus are both important, immensely important, and must be given with equal force and power. What are they? Commandments of God. What do the commandments of God teach us? Of a coming judgment. And the faith of Jesus. Faith, Jesus, the Word of God, is the author and finisher of our faith. Okay, these are absolutely necessary, but they're how are they to go forward? With equal force. But we've only lifted up one casually. Do you see where we're deficient as a people? We're kind of running to catch up to the train. But listen, it's the last message of mercy to go to the world. We are to reveal the God's character of love within our church and without our church. They will know we are Christians by our love. Closing here now. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 as we're closing. First Corinthians chapter 13. Now, I said this yesterday when we were together, but I'll tell you, it's so powerful, and others are here now, and I just don't want us to miss this. You know, the just shall live by their faith, right? So, if you've got faith, you're saved. Is that right? What does your faith have to possess?
Charity.
Love. Now, I just recently saw this. I never even saw it. I was reading again 1 Corinthians. The Lord led me back there. And in verse 2, beginning in verse 1, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, I am become a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. But watch this. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries, if this were possible, you know, God's saying, if this were possible and you did possess this, and understand all mysteries and all knowledge. God has all knowledge. If you had the mind of God, all right, if you understood all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so you can have complete faith, and it says, it defines it, so that I could remove mountains. So let's say that, I don't know about you, but I always thought, well, man, if I had faith that could just move mountains, then I'd be in. I'd be set. Nothing could move me. But God is saying that if you have faith, even that can move mountains, and you don't have my love, brothers and sisters, it would be better if he said, you're counted least in heaven, but he doesn't say that. You are nothing. Because love is everything.
Amen.
And if you don't possess that love, his character, if that's not the principle that governs your choices every day, come on, love is a principle. If that's not the principle governing your choices every day, then you are as nothing. I am as nothing. Line upon line, Jesus wrote this book. Inculcated within his word are the principles of his law. They're set before us in the setting of parables, of stories, even allegories. But brothers and sisters, make no mistake. God gave you and I this word because he wants you to see him in it. He wants you to understand his whole motivation for sending Jesus was his love, was his character, was his law. And that's what Jesus not only honored, glorified on the cross, but he magnified. And yet, when we push away the precepts and principles in our studies, then we are setting aside the very character of God. And we can't behold him. And we can't become changed by that very law. May God help us to understand that in your studies, it must be precept upon precept, precept upon precept. Shall we pray? My Father, I'm amazed. I don't know what to say. But even though I've just been the one to speak it, I realize that I must know you. I must become like you. And my heart is encouraged because I realize that your precepts, while they are showing me where I'm deficient, they're also a promise that you can do this work in me. And because of your mercy towards us, you do reveal to us where we are falling short, where we are out of sync with heaven. And in this time, in this brief amount of time before our whole world just falls apart, you're calling to us to become like Jesus. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Father, I want to lift my brothers and sisters up that are here today and those that are hearing this later. May they be encouraged to know that though Satan is lying firmly and strongly about them and their worth in the eyes of heaven, may they know that you sent Jesus for them. Yes, for them, if just for them. And that they are of the greatest price to you, greatest value. May we find hope and encouragement in your word, through your promises, through your parables, through the stories, as we behold the principles of your law, which are love for God and love for man. Teach us, Father, for we are ignorant and we do not want to remain in darkness one day longer. We want to be among those that are standing in the light. We thank you and praise you for this opportunity. And again, Father, I lift my brothers that will follow me up in prayer throughout the rest of this week that are presenting your message. May they be encouraged and inspired. And may your holy angels minister unto them. For we pray this all, that Jesus would be glorified, that he would be lifted up and magnified. In his name we pray. Amen.